End of chapter 17. This is chapter 18 of Huckleberry Finn. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Adventures of Huckleberry Finn by Mark Twain, chapter 18. Colonel Grangerford, Aristocracy, Feuds, The Testament, Recovering the Raft, The Woodpile, Pork and Cabbage.
Colonel Grangerford was a gentleman, you see. He was a gentleman all over, and so was his family. He was well-born, as the saying is, and that's worth as much in a man as it is in a horse, so the Widow Douglas said. And nobody ever denied that she was one of the first aristocracy in our town, and Pap, he always said it, too, though he weren't no more quality than a mudcat himself. Colonel Grangerford was very tall and very slim, and had a darkish, paly complexion, not a sign of red in it anywheres. He was clean-shaved every morning all over his thin face, and he had the thinnest kind of lips, and the thinnest kind of nostrils, and a high nose, and heavy eyebrows, and the blackest kind of eyes, sunk so deep back that they seemed like they was looking out of caverns at you, as you may say. His forehead was high, and his hair was black and straight, and hung to his shoulders. His hands was long and thin, and every day of his life he put on a clean shirt and a full suit from head to foot, made out of linen, so white it hurt your eyes to look at it. And on Sundays he wore a blue tailcoat with brass buttons on it. He carried a mahogany cane with a silver head to it. There weren't no frivolishness about him, not a bit, and he weren't ever loud. He was as kind as he could be, you could feel that, you know, and so you had confidence. Sometimes he smiled, and it was good to see, but when he straightened himself up like a liberty pole and the lightning began to flicker out from under his eyebrows, you wanted to climb a tree first and find out what the matter was afterwards. He didn't ever have to tell anybody to mind their manners. Everybody was always good-mannered where he was. Everybody loved to have him around, too. He was sunshine most always. I mean, he made it seem like good weather. When he turned into a cloud-bank, it was awful dark for half a minute, and that was enough. There wouldn't nothing go wrong again for a week. When him and the old lady come down in the morning, all the family got up out of their chairs and give them good day, and didn't set down again till they had set down. Then Tom and Bob went to the sideboard where the decanter was, and mixed a glass of bitters and handed it to him, and he held it in his hand and waited till Tom's and Bob's was mixed, and then they bowed and said, "Our duty to you, sir and madam," and they bowed the least bit in the world, and said, "Thank you," and so they drank, all three, and Bob and Tom poured a spoonful of water on the sugar and the mite of whiskey or apple brandy in the bottom of their tumblers, and give it to me and Buck, and we drank to the old people, too. Bob was the oldest, and Tom next, tall, beautiful men with their very broad shoulders and brown faces, and long black hair and black eyes. They dressed in white linen, from head to foot, like the old gentleman, and wore broad Panama hats. Then there was Miss Charlotte. She was 25, and tall, and proud and grand, but as good as she could be when she weren't stirred up. But when she was, she had a look that would wilt you in your tracks, like her father. She was beautiful. So was her sister, Miss Sophia, but it was a different kind. She was gentle and sweet like a dove, and she was only 20. Each person had their own nigger to wait on them, Buck, too. My nigger had a monstrous easy time, because I weren't used to having anybody do anything for me, but Buck's was on the jump most of the time. This was all there was of the family now, but there used to be more, three sons. They got killed, and Emmeline, that died.